What you feel you know that may have a different view than your own? Then let's talk to one another. Let's reason with one another on a scriptural discussion with the Son of Man. A live broadcast Wednesdays and Fridays at 9 p.m. So why don't you call in and let's discuss the Holy Bible, and if you have one, the Holy Quran, and come to an agreement about the Holy Scripture and their true meaning. So tune in to a scriptural discussion with the Son of Man every Wednesday and Friday at 9 p.m. right here on TV33 and 88.1 FM WHPR. You can call in on the air or off the air at 868-0351, 868-0342, and 868-4336. Of course, the area code is 313. That's 868-0351, 868-4336, and 868-0342.
In the name of Allah, the Beneficent, the Most Merciful, the Truthful, and the Most Just, I greet all of you within the sound of my voice with the greeting words of peace from the Lord of the world. Allah, Salaam Alaikum. I have some things that I want to share with you to make clear to you that even though it may look like it's a glamorous, you've heard the old saying, the grass always looks greener on the other side of the fence. If a lot of people who are adults were questioned about would they trade places, if they could trade places, would they go back to high school or whatnot? Most would say yes. You're going to discover, as you get older, you always want what you don't have. That is something that I've been learning. You notice you have when you was in your mother's house, you wanted to be grown. When you was in elementary school, you wanted to get to you envied the junior high school student. When you got to junior high school, you envied the high school student. And you know, when your parents' job looks so glamorous to you because you don't see all the headache that came with it, and so you was wishing you could trade places with them. And so it's always never. That's what desire is. That's one of the reasons why desire is called fire. You know, it's just like when the scripture says, better to marry than to burn, meaning to walk around lusting all the time, just going to get married. Do you understand? To burn, meaning to have so much desire that it begins to consume you. You know, you mess around. I remember when I was there's very few little boys that didn't get a hold to an alcohol bottle and pour alcohol on their, well, I guess it might not have been, but you pour alcohol on your hand and strike a match and light it and watch it burn, and it didn't bust until you mess around there and let it go too long. you know, and I don't mean to put nothing on your mind. That's not intelligent. That's foolish to do. But you play with fire, you get burnt. You know, so the desire is like fire, and it will consume you. You start following all your desires, and pretty soon you won't be here. It's just like nobody they had in the military was called fire watch. And that is not just, I mean, when we was in the billet, you know, we had a heater in there that was actually fire in it. But that's not really what fire watch is. Yeah, that's just another way of saying look out for any kind of trouble. You know, and you're the one that's got to, you know, if there's fire, you got to wake everybody. If there's a problem, you got to wake everybody. Do you understand? Fire watch. You know, any danger. But anyway, if many times there's another old saying: be careful what you wish for. Why? Because you just might get it. And what that's saying, many people wish that they could be in charge. Now, I want to tell you something. That's the one thing I did not never wish for. If you look at Jonah's history, Jonah wasn't interested in going wanting nobody, and I never wanted to be no preacher. I never really wanted to be over nobody. And just when I got so at peace and happy, and had figured out that all I need to do is just believe in the messenger of God and follow him. And I finally had figured that out and totally submitted. Then he was gone, and then I discovered that I was the one that had to do this. And, you know, the messenger said, if you're dealing with truth, you're dealing with Allah. You ever sit down and watch somebody doing something? And you knew how to do it. And you were sitting there watching them mess it up. How long could you be quiet? Did you ever notice you was trying not to say nothing? But something in you, the knowledge that was in you wouldn't let you be quiet. You had to say, hey, man, or hey, you messing that up. That's not how you do that, right? And that's just the way it is. And that's, Allah imposes not on any soul a duty beyond its ability. But to whom much is given, to whom much understanding is given, then much is required. When you're in a world full of error, everywhere you look, people are doing things and are in error, then, and you've been given much if you have understanding, then much is required of you. You don't believe it, just know how to do something and see somebody messing it up. I'm not talking about think you know. I'm talking about know you know. And see how long you can be quiet when you see somebody messing it up. Then you will better understand that leadership, you know, the job chooses the one to do it. And it's always the one who best knows how to do it. Now, I want to say, I want to let you hear something. Here's a brother You remember when Peter was telling Jesus, let's read it. Where is that where Peter was telling Jesus he was going to give his life for him? Jesus told him before the cock crow, you're going to be done denied me three times, man. Where is that? Go to Matthew, the 26th chapter. Is that the only place it's in? Huh? I know it ain't. Says, where did Mark is? 14 and what? 14 and 30. Listen. And Luke 22. Now you see why they call them the four gospels. That's witnesses is giving their version of Matthew's version, Mark, Luke's, and John's version. Huh? Let it be in the mouth of two or more witnesses. Huh? Now, Luke what? 22, and we're going to go to Luke. I want y'all to keep up here because I want to show you something. Now, in the 31st verse, it says, and the Lord, now remember something. God called everyone that his word came to. He called them God. They were lords of men. Do you understand? And as Jesus reminded the hypocrites that was somebody stoning him for saying he was the Son of God, he said, well, ain't it written in your law? I have said ye are God. And if he called them gods unto whom the word of God came, then what are you? Come on, I'm blaspheming because I said I'm the Son of God. What's your problem? Do you understand? Okay. And the Lord said, Simon, Simon, behold, Satan hath desired to have you that he may sift you as wheat. Huh? And it says, but I have prayed for thee that thy faith fail not. And when thou art converted, what do you say? When you are converted, huh? Strengthen thy brethren. Why did he say when you converted? He knew Peter wasn't no believer yet. Huh? Peter thought he was, right? Listen to what Peter said. And he said unto him, Lord, I'm ready to go with thee, both into prison and to death. Is that what he said? He was ready, wasn't he? And Jesus said unto him, I tell thee, Peter, the cock shall not crow this day before that thou shalt thrice, meaning three times, deny that thou knowest me. Huh? You know, you'd be surprised. You'd be surprised how not willing you are to give up your life. You know how people come out what they will do? Yeah, but when the time comes. Huh? As those say, go, yeah, all these people talk about, well, when you die, you're going on to heaven, and it'll be a better place. But watch them when they get sick. how quick they run to the doctor. Tell them, why don't you go on to that better place? I'm going to the better place. I'm going to the doctor. Is that right? Everybody talking about going to heaven, but don't nobody want to die. Is that what that old saying too? You know why? Because the teachings of dying and going to heaven is the same as the teachings of Santa Claus. Everybody say it, but they know it ain't so. They talking about, you know, Santa don't bring you touching toe. Well, that's what they tell the children. And the children, they get a kick out of watching the children's eyes light up. Their eyes would light up just as big and nice if you say, Mama and Daddy finna go down here and get you something. Gonna get you that toy you wanted. Gonna get you this that you want. Their eyes would still light up. But something else would be different. Instead of them loving a fictitious character, they would love you. I should say, at least they'd appreciate you. And they would know that you're the one doing all that good for them. Huh? So, stop lying to people. Where's that one that went to that heaven you talking about and came back and told you about it? Huh? And you get all kind of crazy answers from people when they say, you don't believe Jesus died, man, and came back? So, okay, if I believe that, okay. Where you at now? Well, he's sitting on the right hand of the Father. He went away in a cloud. Well, if he went away in a cloud, he's still in the atmosphere of the earth. Because don't no clouds go out in space. So where is he? And the more you question them about the things that they're telling you, the more you realize that they're telling you other than the truth, and they know that they're telling you other than the truth. That's why they get mad when I say something like this about it. Now, they mad. Mad about what? You mad because I told your children that there's no such thing as a flying reindeer? And a little fat man in a red suit going all around the earth bringing gifts to everybody on Christmas. He couldn't even go all over the state in one night. Let alone all over the country. And if he do come to your house with all them alarm systems you got, he gonna be in a world of trouble. I know I'm being a little lighthearted with you. But I'm trying to make you see how them stories that you've been telling that got all them holes in it, so the truth is sifting through. You know, a sift, it only holds certain things back. It's designed to hold big stuff and let the flour come on through. Do you understand? So the truth is coming through. You see, and people who love truth, Satan ain't got nothing to hold you. You know, so you come on through the wheat, the real wheat. We're not talking about the fiber. We're talking about the wheat. You see, we want the wheat to come through. You see, so these are they that came through great tribulation. And have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb after being under the domain and dominion of Satan. Do you understand? So now, you know, I'm the only man that's like you. And I'm the only human being on this earth that can stand up and talk like this and don't nobody challenge them on. I'm the only man that on this earth that can stand up and talk about the Holy Scriptures and get no challenge from nobody. Oh, it's a lot of them would like to, but they want to do it privately so that they don't get showed up in the public. But I don't do private. I don't do private discussion. You go back and lie about what happened. But if it happened in front of everybody, then everybody heard it. It's just like when they went out and found that little book. You remember that Anton Beatty fella? Went out and found that little book that some of them hypocrites had put their own little stuff in there. Somebody at the messenger said that the white man wouldn't make it to the moon. How in the world could he say that when the scripture plainly says that Satan would ascend above the clouds? And Allah, even the messenger had been teaching on that, that Allah would give him a peek into the what happened. Even going up there and finding out that the rocks on the moon correspond with the rocks on the earth, except for they didn't have quite as much water in them. You know, and he ain't gonna tell you what else he found. But don't nobody want to go to the moon no more. And so, you know. You notice he didn't come back and say, y'all lying. The moon is a whole sphere, and the moon wasn't blasted away from the earth. He ain't said nothing like that. And ain't nobody, you know, it's curious how people don't never ask, what's that ring doing around the moon sometimes? Huh? The only thing would explain it is the water vapor that was there in the form of mud. Huh? Yeah. If it once had water on it. It still got some water residue on it. They even told you they found ice on the moon. Now, that's his little hint. That's as much as he's going to tell you. Now, you put the rest together on your own. But you notice they go around the earth. They found this man in some pastor somewhere. He said that all the homosexuals and lesbians should be put behind an electrical fence. Put all the lesbians behind one and the homosexual men and just fly over and drop some food until they all die. Now, they found him. But they can't seem to find me and ask me nothing. You know, because they know I'm not going to tell them nothing that makes people think that religious people are crazy. You know, if you think that you can get rid of any kind of evil by killing the one who's doing it, you living in a dream world. You didn't learn nothing from the past 6,000 years of wars and the reason they was fought and what the result was. Huh? Until, you know, That's the one thing that even Satan told us. He been told you, and he was right. You can't legislate morals. How you think all these people coming out the closet? What was they in the closet for? Because it was against the law to do what they were doing. So the legislature made it against the law, and so the people just hid and did it. So you can't make people upright with law no more than you can make a person who has an affliction in their leg. You can put a stick on it, but the minute you take that stick away, they still cripple. The idea is to give them, operate on them if you know how. Repair what's wrong. Then they don't need no stick. Allah don't want no people. He got to make laws. And if you got laws, you got to have law keepers. And you got to have somewhere to put people that break the law. And then you got to have judges and whatnot. But that ain't going. That ain't what's been the. That, we done had a world like that, and it didn't work. It's falling apart right now. And all of them hear me saying it, and ain't nobody can come in here and say, I don't know what I'm talking about. Here, these people, they don't even have sense enough to know that they don't know how to raise no children. You know how you know that? Because the way they've been telling you to raise your children, the jails is more full of young people now than ever was. You didn't find no bunch of young people sitting up in jail when your daddy was at the house and putting something on your rump. And wasn't no government coming in there talking about what he can't do. This is what you do. When the government won't let you raise them, give them to the government. You raise them. They'll fix you. That's right. You see? But now let's talk to you a little bit here. What happened with Peter? You know that when the thing came down to it, let's go over here. Jesus had told him, everybody know the story, when he came down to it, Peter started cussing. And said, I don't know the man. I told you I don't know the so-and-so. Is that right? Okay. So, this is why the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, when he was here, he told the people, he said, now I'm the only man of your kind who can stand up and talk like this. And don't you try to do it unless you say what I see. In other words, you tell them that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said so-and-so. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said so-and-so. Don't stand up there like you can be, as he called Peter to mind. He said, like the foolish Peter. He saw Jesus walking on the water, and he thought he could come out there and walk on it. And then the foolish man started sinking and had to call on Jesus to help him, to save him. Huh? You know, you can't have faith in something you don't know nothing about. Walking on water means walking on faith, man. And you can't have faith in something that you don't understand. You can only have faith. Faith is total trust. You know, it's just like if you take off in your car and you ain't never been cross country in it, but you say, "I emergency done came up, I got to go out west, I'll see you, I got to go up north, or I got to go here, I got to go there, I'll see you when I get back. Tell everybody I had to go, an emergency came up." You didn't give a second thought to whether your vehicle could go because that vehicle hadn't been giving you no trouble and had been serving you well, and you had a knowledge of the vehicle that made you trust it because of the knowledge that you had of that vehicle. Do you understand? Now, what if you had been every now and then, it run hot, you had to pull over, open up the radiator thing and pull some water in there. Then this thing got a water leak somewhere, and then somebody say, well, it's an emergency out there. You say, I can't trust that car to go. I got to go rent me a van. I got to go rent me a car or something. Why? Because I don't trust that thing. Why? Because it's been breaking down on me all the time. It done taught me not to trust. Is that right? Okay. So this is something that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he told everybody that in the theology of time he was teaching. He said, now I'm the only man of your kind who can stand up and talk like this, and don't you try to do it unless you say what I say. And you notice, all of them that tried to get up and talk to white folks, like the messenger did, and talk about white folk, they all got called on the carpet by white people. And as good as the white man, as good as told them, you need to shut your mouth. Huh? And you heard him on there. You remember when, for instance, you remember when Minister Farrakhan went on Phil Donahue? And Donahue kept on asking him about the gutter religion thing? And he said, now, Mr. Donahue, you said we wasn't going to talk. And Donahue just shrugged his shoulders. And, but you never heard any of them call the Honorable Elijah Muhammad on the carpet for what he said, and then the messenger got out there and started backpedaling and trying to explain himself. Now, did you? The only other one you ain't never heard do that is me. You remember when Mr. Neubauer brought up me calling white people devils? I think I asked him, you sure you want to go there? is that what I asked him? Because I reminded him, you know, y'all called each other devils a long time before we did, before we woke up to it. That's what I was saying. You know, I mean, poor devil, handsome devil, dare devil, picky devil, speak of the devil. What's up, bub? I know what bub means. It's Beelzebub. Now, do you show you want to talk to me about that? I ain't going to back up. Maybe you don't want to hear the answer. Do you want me to prove it? And you notice he don't say nothing else. He got off of that quick. Now, I'm not offering you salvation because I'm scared of you. I'm not up here talking peace to white people because I fear white people. I'm talking peace and trying to make peace with them because I was told to do that. Son of man, warn the wicked. The Honorable Elijah Muhammad said to me, it's like he wasn't talking to nobody but me. He said, now don't blame them for what by nature you put in them. He said, blame yourself for putting it in. And if you say he's not righteous, he will say that I was not my maker, and that'll stop your mouth. Huh? So, I don't blame the devil for being what he was made, especially since I'm in that group that helped make him. I wasn't always knowledgeable that I was that, kind of like the story of the ugly duckling. He wasn't aware that he was one of them birds that he admired so much until one day he looked down there and saw a picture of himself that he never saw before. Huh? And then he realized that he was one of them. He was just dead to that knowledge. I was dead to the knowledge of myself, but now I know who I am. And so, you know, and when white people, there's been a lot of train of white people coming back and forth and yet checking me. And all of them found that they couldn't deal with me, and they left me alone. You won't make me back up off of the truth that I know. But I said all of that. Now I want you to hear something. Now, this is the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And I'm going to tell you what. First, I'm going to let you hear something else. Now, this is a brother that is has a organization called CROE, and it's the Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah. And to say it how I think they meant it. The Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Do you understand? Now, you're going to hear some senators questioning him about the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And you're going to hear him get backed into a corner, and because he didn't know what answer to give, he did like Peter did. Do you understand? I want you to listen. I'm going to let you hear basically the whole thing.
Good morning, Sheriff. And I mean, Senator.
Thank you also for coming to my office. And I wish we had had more time to talk, but schedules didn't allow that.
You promised that we would.
Well, we'll do that then.
Yes, sir.
Some of the things we talked about, the one issue that I have, and this is certainly not an attack on what anyone believes, but you have a website, and on your resume was it's called CROE, it's the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Yes, sir.
And since this is in the public domain, it's out there for everybody to see, and the issue that I have, I guess the problem I have, is that some of the comments were, I know were made not by yourself, but by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad,
yes, sir,
and probably some 80 years ago,
yes, sir,
and in his writings. But some of those to me are incendiary. You know, there some of the comments made, some of what his beliefs were under listing what Muslims believe and what they want under his comments about that are listed there. And I guess the as it starts out on the home page, it talks about the plain truth given to us by our leader and teacher. And I guess that's an acknowledgement of what he said. But some of the things he says in this, as we've talked, I think are kind of disturbing. And so that's the problem I have, I guess, especially when we put these things out there in the public domain. And I've watched several episodes of your show on the internet, and I didn't see a lot of the things that are said here repeated.
Right.
But could you...
Now before I let you finish hearing this, are you aware that most of your senators and congressmen, they have law degrees? And I learned from some of the brothers that I have had dealings with who were lawyers. And one of the first, you know, I learned something about how lawyers think. And they say one of the first things that a good lawyer learns is not to ask a question that he don't already know the answer to. That's why it's called building a case. It's just like building a house. A carpenter don't pick up a board that he don't know where it's going to go. If he want to go fishing, he go fishing, but he ain't going to go fishing in court. Going fishing in court is dangerous. Because when you don't know what your answer is going to be, you don't know if it's going to be something that's going to help your case or hurt your case. Do you understand? So, but these senators was asking him questions after he done had a little conversation off the record with him. You know, I mean that was really a quick deposition. And there ain't no sense in you thinking that if you come in to the front of U.S. senators and they sifting you, they're not looking for the reason to let you be there. They're looking to see if there's any reason why they don't think you should be confirmed. Huh? But he thought that was a good old boy, and we're gonna usher you right on the end and give you our seal of approval, and it's just a formality. But no, there's not no formality. But I want you to listen. This is Brother Munir in front of the panel trying to be reaffirmed as, what's that, human rights? The Human Rights Board of Human Rights? Human Rights Commission. He was trying to remain on that board. And so listen to this conversation.
I guess give me some assurance, or I'm just struggling with this issue.
Yeah, I think I shared with you, I'm a person that is accepted by many people all around the world. And when we talk about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, I suggested that you look at it in context. That's a biography on him. I'm an archivist where we maintain a history. And as I shared with you, we had different histories. And so I didn't know mine, you know, quite frankly, sir. And what I wanted to do is to make sure that I get acquainted with that history. So I mentioned to you about the Constitution.
See, he was in, so Brother Munir, and if he's listening, or if you think I'm taking something out of context, you make sure that you let him know. Because I didn't try to get him to come on. I had Brother Jamar to call at, Brother Michael's suggestion. Call him and see if he wanted to come on and talk with us about it. And he was kind of hostile to Brother Jamar. I mean, Brother Jamar. And if you made a poor showing, you made a poor showing. You know, I mean, I already know none of y'all can deal with white people. You the one don't know that. God didn't make him for you to deal with. That's why you were told to wait on the Lord. But anyway, he wouldn't come on. But this forum is open. You can tell him, you can call him up and tell him, man, they're playing your tapes. I got to do this, you know, because it's a lesson in this for you. Now, you run around here. Now, he's there trying to suggest to the senators that he's just an archivist or historian that's trying to preserve the history of Elijah Muhammad. But the man, if he thinks them people don't know that he's been saying he's a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, he's living in a dream world. He ain't no historian or archivist. He's been saying the Honorable Elijah Muhammad was his leader and teacher. Now that's what he's been saying. Huh? Okay. Now, listen to the senators as they, it's two up there. Now, this the good cop here. You know, him and he had already had a conversation with him private. And you see how cordial he's been. Now, just listen.
Touche. We can't go back and change the Constitution when they suggest that we're three-fifths of a human being, but that's there, you know? And I'm telling you, it is a biography of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, the archivist, and I told you that I deal with people from all walks of life. You asked me another question off the record relative to another person. You wanted to know my views on those persons, and I happened to share with you an invitation that these persons had sent to me. We can talk about it openly, or it doesn't matter. My point is,
another mistake he made. Now he's nervous. So now he's talking about other people that he was asked about and his opinion on them. And if you wasn't going to say who those people was, you never should have brought that up. Do you understand? You know, if you're going to be damned, then you ought to let yourself be damned for being who you are and not who you trying to fake like you are. Do you understand what I'm saying? Because if you was being yourself, then yourself wasn't good enough. But if you was trying to be what you thought somebody else wanted you to be instead of just going on being yourself, now you got to figure out or wonder if not being yourself is what the reason why you was not accepted. If you honest enough to tell me how you feel, it's just like Caucasian people here in Mississippi. They get they have a bad and a good reputation at the same time. Because the Caucasian in Mississippi, especially back in the 50s and 60s, if he told you he was your friend or he didn't have no problem with you, he didn't have no problem with you. He didn't play them kind of games. He just told you where you stood. Nigga, don't come to my door. Or, yeah, come on, John. You all right with me? And if he said that, he meant that. People like that you can deal with. In other words, his word meant something to him. Most of the southern white people, their word meant something to them. That's why I thanked the governor. Remember Governor Haley Barber? Now, everybody's mad at him. But Governor Barber probably saved a lot of lives with what he did. Because the scripture said, blessed are the merciful. For they what? You know, Governor Barber, me and him talked personally before. He came and asked for our vote, and I voted for him. I did it because he came and asked for it. And he knew who he was talking to. And if he didn't have no problem coming and shaking my hand, and I told him, I said, just, Mr. Barber, when you get in there, just do right by my people. And, you know, I don't know everything that he was up to in there, but I do know that he pardoned a lot of people, and some of them was black. But some of them was white people. A lot of them was white people that he pardoned, too. And y'all better lighten up on that man. You get yourself in trouble messing with people that's trying to do something to please God. Because his word is good, too. As in, whosoever shall offend one of these little ones that believe in me. It'd have been better for him that a millstone was hanged about his neck and he cast into the sea. We used to have old saying, our daddy or whatever said, boy, you'd rather shoot marbles on the freeway than to cross me. And you know how much chance you stand getting out on the freeway playing marbles. You won't have no marbles. is that right? Okay. Well, how far you think you'll get swimming in the sea with a millstone around your neck? The boys and the Godfather say, give him some concrete overshoes. Is that what they call concrete? Put him on some concrete shoes. and that means put you in a bucket with some cement in it until it get hard, and then throw you over in the in the river. Where they get that from? A millstone around your neck, you know? So, but I'm telling you, there's certain things that you used to get away with and get by with, you're not going to get by with today. But anyway, now he's there trying to reinvent himself as not a follower, but as an archivist. Big mistake, especially with that website that they got, with all of that, talking about he's a follower of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Huh? But anyway, he went down that road, and so they let him walk. Now listen.
Is that you're judging Munir Muhammad for his work and what I have done. Those who have been on the commission with me for years, people who have known me, they know of my record. And you asked me, I think, did I want to separate. I told you I had the aspirations of becoming a great politician once. And I had been voting all those years, and you said the Honorable Elijah Muhammad didn't vote. So obviously, there was a different well, he didn't. And that was.
Well, I didn't say that.
Oh, okay. But we said a lot of things. In fact, I thought we had a great time. But
see, and then he corrected him on that. He said, "I never said that." No, you was doing the talking. You know, that's something else that we don't realize. You're so used to talking to people who don't listen, which is yourselves. Y'all be arguing with each other and don't neither one of you be listening to the other. That's why you never become friends. Because even when a person says something that should stop the argument, it don't stop because you didn't hear it. But now when you're talking to Caucasian people, if he quiet, especially one of them who are in a position of rulership, he's not just quiet waiting on his turn to speak. He's quiet listening to you. Which you better learn to do. A living man can act like he's dead, but a dead man can't act like he's living. A woke man can play sleep, but a sleep man can't play woke. And you listen. Now, not only, you know, Brother Munir, if he finally hear this, see, this brings you right back to the scripture that says, judge not, that you be not judged. And condemn not that you be not condemned. What is that to say? Now, he's been calling people hypocrites. He's been calling other people who he saw deny the teaching hypocrites. But if you got a price yourself, I wouldn't accuse nobody else of taking a bribe if I was you, because if you got a price, the devil gonna offer it to you one day. That's why you should have just, what you should have been doing was trying to study the teachings yourself and looking for the one that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad told you was coming after him. But no, you want to set up what's the acronym, CROE, what it stands for? Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah. When did the Honorable Elijah Muhammad tell you to do something like that after he gone? He told you to do nothing like that. Because that's one of the things that makes you look back instead of looking forward. You're looking back trying to hold on to somebody that Allah done took away. When you should be remembering what that man taught and looking for the one that he said was coming after him. Oh, you're going to hear him say that the Nation of Islam don't exist. And he's partially right. He was partially right. Because it's a work in progress now. The foundation for it exists. But it's now being built on that foundation. But he said it started and stopped with the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad never said the Nation of Islam starts and stops with him. He said he was laying the foundation for a new nation. Do that sound like start and stop with me? But listen, you'll hear all these things. Now I'm going to try not to cut in no more. But I need you to hear what I hear. Like that song, do you hear what I hear? No, how in the world are you going to hear what I hear? Do your hand hear what your head hear? Unless the head pull it out of the way make the feet move out the way. The feet can't hear the car coming. Can't see it either. But it's as if they saw it, if the head saw it, because the head immediately lets them move as though they saw it. Do you understand now? All right, listen.
All I can say to you, sir, is that I live here in America, and every time I travel, the first thing I think about, what day will I get back? You know, so I'm here in America. I plan to be here. I'm not trying to separate from you, anybody else. So I don't know in what other way that I could answer you. But I told you that technically I'm not inclined. I don't do the websites, not because I don't want to.
Did you hear that? That's Munir Muhammad. He not trying to separate from white people and nobody else. Well, why not? I thought you was a follower of the messenger. How you going to have your own country, your freedom, justice, and equality if you don't want to separate from your slave master? How you going to be your daddy's equal in your daddy's house? And if you think that, you a fool. And if he mean you any good, he gonna pull you to the side and say, "Look, son, let me tell you something. I can't make you my equal. You have to go and do for yourself what daddy done for himself. That makes you my equal. I can't make you my equal if I wanted to, son. If I got to make you my equal, you're not my equal." Do you understand? I'm not talking to you on no individual level. I was trying to show you a point in your daddy's house. Well, in this Caucasian country, you can't be his equal. And what you should be doing is having a conversation with him to say, "You said you freed us. When are you going to make good on that?" Well, what do you mean? I mean, when you going to have a serious conversation with me now that I'm awake? I'm talking to him now. Now that I'm up and awake, are you ready to make good on your saying that you ready to abolish slavery? Because as long as my people are in a position of freed workers for you, well, they're not free. We can't be free without land. You ain't gave us no land, and you know that there's no such thing as freedom without land. You know? But you heard Munir. Now, this is a man that's supposed to be following the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, sitting there talking about he ain't trying to separate from nobody. As though separating from white people is a crime, or wanting to be somewhere to ourselves, is something wrong with that. But he went down that path and started denying, so the man just kept on asking him questions about it. Because he didn't know how to deal with them the way they were coming to him. And it should not have been an issue, but he helped make it an issue. So he He opened the door, they went through it. Do you understand? Okay, listen.
I don't know how, you know, so just saying to you, but you're going to...
Can you see, though, how some of the statements on that website would be disturbing to people?
I would see that if you didn't look at it in context and when it was and the conditions of at that time. You know, I told you that I don't go around acknowledging the 3/5 of a human being, but that's there, you know?
Okay.
And I, you know, so I do my best.
Mr. Chairman, may I comment there?
Yes,
I think, and I had a great conversation with Senator Bivens also, and I think it's important that we restore our history and that we make it available. And a lot of our history isn't pretty. A lot of our history is a lot of hurt and pain, but it's the history. And as a historian and an archivist, if they're not his comments, and as a historian...
Now, Sister thought that she was doing Brother Munir a favor by trying to defend him. But she actually was doing him a disservice. And by him letting her jump in to try to defend him, let me see, put the woman out front and the Negro man behind instead. But you better not never, don't you ever call yourself, when I'm out talking to Caucasian people, I don't even want brothers jumping in. But I certainly don't want my woman to have to come there and defend me. That's not her place. If I've taken an untenable position, I need to change my position. Untenable means I can't defend myself by taking this position. Then what you take it for? But you make yourself look weak by calling on your woman to defend you, man. If I was him, I'd have said, no, sister. No, that's okay. I got it. Do you understand? And y'all know I ain't joking. How many times y'all went to raise your hand in a meeting of mine, and I told y'all, you be quiet. I don't need you. I'm not talking something that I need a crowd of people to bear with me to help me to put it over. A lot is sufficient as a help for me. That song that when we used to believe in Jesus, that on the Jericho Road, there's room for just two. No more, no less. Just Jesus and you. Well, no more, no less. Just Allah and me. That's sufficient. He said, behold my servant whom I uphold. He didn't say who all my people uphold. He said, whom I uphold. Mine elect, in whom my soul delighted. So, don't ever jump in. See, but, I mean, she was trying to defend him, but she couldn't defend him because he had already messed around there and denied what he claimed he believed in. And he was still on his way to denying it even further. Listen.
Then I don't see why it's a problem based on something a leader of our community said some years ago, based on the lifestyle that was given at that time. And if we think about religion, I think so many of us share so many different religions. That's the beauty of all of us. We have different beliefs. We're diversity. And I think that's what the Human Rights Commission is all about.
Definitely.
It should be a level of diversity that has a reflection on many different walks of life, many different religions and backgrounds and beliefs, because that's what the state of Illinois looks like. That's who we are. We're not a one-sided or one particular group or person or belief. And so I like to hope that we can move from Mr. Munir's adoption. I've not heard from any other members that he's served with. This is a reappointment. We've not heard that there's been any challenges with him on the commission, and I hope we could move forward with this reappointment.
Thank you.
Senator Ryder.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning.
Good morning.
I want to follow up, actually, on some of the things that Senator Bivens asked you about, but a theme that actually Senator Lightford raised. I've looked at your website. In fact, I have a copy of the printout here. One of the pages, it talks about what Muslims want.
See, now the good cop, Penny. You remember from the, I was come upon them from the left and from the right? Huh? Yeah. That's what good cop, bad cop is, from the left and the right. One as a friend, and the other one is just well. I got to ask you this. You've been talking crazy. Now listen to how this senator goes after him.
And there are several declarations in here that start. All of them start with the words "we want," and then there's different things in here. And now, first, I ask you. Now, you're part of the group that originated this website, correct?
I guess you would say that, yes.
Okay.
I have a website, CROETV.org.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And you're listed pretty prominently
in
here. So I want to make sure that I'm right insofar as attribution to your contribution to the website.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Who's the we? Who's the we?
That was the 1930, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad and those that he was with. The man that was put in jail for teaching his own children on 11th and State. The man who was sent to prison for...
Now, he asked him a straightforward question. Who is the we? That was his opportunity to do what? The Honorable Elijah Muhammad and us who follow him. Right? But listen to how he's answered. That was back in 1930. So we don't want this no more. And that was Elijah Muhammad that wanted that. Huh? But the man already knew the answer to the question. What the Muslims want and what we the Muslims believe. Let's see here. I mean, what did we miss here? What the Muslims want and what the Muslims believe. That wasn't just back in 1930. I mean, if you don't still want it, it wasn't worth wanting back then. Unless you done got it already. And even then, we still want it. Is that right? But now, see, they're trying to see what kind of man he is now. Understand something. You know, you ain't know. Look, the Japanese attacked America, right? How does America treat Japan today? They respect the Japanese, don't they? But how do you respect a man that does not have respect for his own manhood? Understand something. I'm not so much as doing this to embarrass Brother Munir. I'm doing this to show you that the point that the messenger was trying to make for you a long time ago. You need leadership. You don't need to be out here trying to everybody do his own thing. You need to get with the one who can get you what you want. So, listen.
Something that he was too old to go to the war. That's the man, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
Okay.
I was not born.
Okay.
Yeah, and I've shared with you, and I think Senator Lightfoot said it much better than I could have ever said it, of what I do. You know, I didn't put the website together because, as I told you, I don't do that. But that's a biography, if you look at it, of the Honorable Elijah
well,
Muhammad.
No, actually, the section I'm referring to is absolutely not a biography. That would be where the person...
You say the biography of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
If I could finish, then why don't you and I have a conversation here. You'll understand where I'm going with this. Okay? It says, I mean, a biography is who a person was, where they were born, maybe what they believed in.
Okay.
This is, I'm just
what
trying...
What they believe
to,
in.
Okay.
Okay.
When it says we want, I'm simply asking. I'm not trying to make a point here. I'm asking for information. Who is the we? Is that Muslims? Is that the creators of the website? Or is it just Elijah Muhammad, but you're just using we rather than he?
Well, he certainly wrote it, the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. See, there is no Nation of Islam since he's no longer here, as the archivist. That's one of the reasons that it's like that. In 1975,
did you hear that? Actually, he knew the answer to the question, but this brother was so nervous and trying to hold on to a $49,000 a year job, and he was thinking more about that than he was thinking about what he was being asked. He's saying what the Muslims want, and he asked them, who is the we? And he wouldn't even say the Muslim. He said, that's Elijah Muhammad. Huh? I know y'all mad at me. You can be mad at me all you want. But you better learn. You better learn who you should be mad at. You, the only one he got a right to be mad at is himself. If he had been a follower, I'd have probably been at the hearing with him. And I would have told him. As a matter of fact, he'd have knew how to answer all of that stuff. It wouldn't even went that far. If I asked all of y'all, how would you have dealt with it? That's my point. How would you have dealt with it? See, the thing is, you have to know how to make people back off. You don't have to be confrontational. The man got a right to know what you got on your mind, especially you're going to be over a Human Rights Commission. Huh? So you can't get mad at him for questioning what you believe in and all that kind of stuff. But you got to know how to answer people in order to set their mind at ease and they can move on and let you go on back to work. But the way he going, he ain't setting nobody's mind at ease. You know, they toying with him like a cat with a mouse now. Listen.
Have that ended that. He was the Nation of Islam. He is the Nation of Islam. That's a point that needs to be made clear.
Are you part of that?
Yeah, I'm an archivist.
You're not part of the Nation of Islam?
We don't call it the Nation of Islam.
What do you call it?
I call it CROE, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. Are you questioning what my religious beliefs are?
No, I'm trying to find out whether or not the statements here that say we want, whether or not you feel like you're part of the we. Maybe I should have started it that way.
Yeah, maybe you should. Let me say this. The most prominent part of that this man asked me about was, did I believe in separation? Am I a person that's functioning like I believe in separation, sir? That's the part that I don't understand. You didn't address when we talk about the three-fifths of a human being. Do we talk about George Washington, who owned slaves, Thomas Jefferson?
Well, we can, he's not before the table for a hearing.
But I'm just saying, you make me defensive as if that I'm not entitled to any history.
I'm not doing that.
That's the way it appears to me, sir.
Okay, I'm simply asking whether or not you consider yourself part of the we. It's not an attack. I'm just asking whether or not you consider yourself part of it. That's it.
Yeah, well... What you're asking me, I just don't see how that's relevant in the way that you're putting it.
Well, okay, let's talk about why it's relevant, and I'll follow up on Senator Lyford's point. You're on the Human Rights Commission.
Right.
We talk about diversity.
Right.
We talk about equality.
Diversity, right.
One of the points made in here has to do with interracial marriage. And the objection on here to interracial marriage, which I'm assuming, I have never served on the Human Rights Commission, but I'm assuming that at some point of some of the execution of the duty of the Human Rights Commission, the issue of interracial marriage could come up.
And I would rule on it.
Okay, so what I'm asking is, in here, the articulated objection, strong objection, the articulated strong objection to interracial marriage, do you share that view?
As I said to the senator, if a person is in love, I don't care who they married. I told him I've been married to the same lady for 41 years. Now, and I really don't understand the question about interracial. Perhaps if I was questioning people about how you feel about this person or that person, I don't see the relevance of that, sir.
You don't see the relevance of me asking a question
about
your view of interracial marriage when you're on the Human Rights Commission? Really?
Because anywhere that I have ruled, sir, I rule with balance and fairness. I think this makes me, being under the conditions that I've come up in America, more qualified than most, because I know what it is to be discriminated against.
Sir, I'll be honest with you, just laid out. If the statement, we believe that intermarriage and race mixing should be prohibited, that's on the website.
Okay.
If you have any notion of that you believe that's true, you're not qualified to serve
on
that.
Well, no, I don't.
You ask the relevance, and I'm pointing it out, and I would think that anyone on this committee could see that.
Yeah, well, okay.
Now, do you ascribe to that belief?
No.
You don't?
No.
What he don't realize is that he was trying to show that Munir ain't true to what he claimed he believed in. And if you're not true to that, how can I trust you to be true to the oath that you take here? Do you understand? Well, then how was he supposed to answer? Well, he would, if he had waited on me, then I could have gave him the answer and could have taught him that the way that I teach you all wouldn't even ever question you. Because in the first place, you wouldn't have no website. I'm the only one who got a website. That's the first thing. The second thing is, when you go out on people's job, you know what I teach you. That man ain't paying you to come there and preach to his employees. And if he is paying you to come preach to his employees, you couldn't accept it because I told you you can't go preaching to nobody. But if you out there on a man's job, you're supposed to be doing the job that he hired you for, not out there trying to propagate your religious beliefs. The best way to propagate your religious beliefs is to show people that your religion is practical and teaches you not to be a thief. Because if a man paying you to do a job, and you doing something other than that job on that man's time and then drawing a check, you steal it. An honest day's work for what? An honest pay. If he's honest enough to cut you a check, you should be honest enough to have earned it. But he wanted to be out in front. He wanted to be a big shot. He got a web page. Now, he being questioned about what he got on his web page, and he denying his own web page. You ain't heard the worst of it yet. Listen.
I appreciate you answering that question. Thank you.
Senator Lyford.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I see Senator Ryder has a copy of what the Muslims wants, but it looks like you're missing the heading of that. You just have the actual portion. But if you want to see what the actual website looks like, Okay, then you have to read it. It says biography of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, accomplishments of the Muslims, and then it's in quotes that these are comments that comes from his two writings, What the Muslim Want and What the Muslims Believe, archive history from the Muhammad Speaks newspaper. Then it says questions, a wide awake man should ask quotes from the Elijah Muhammad. So you're constantly questioning this person of when it's clear here that these were newspaper clippings and readings.
See, now they see that they kind of annoying her. Now remember, they say deal only with her. And that's on the William Lynch thing. Now they're going to cut it off in a little while because they see that she's getting upset. You understand? And, you know, I mean, he's sitting there denying everything that he claimed to believe in and letting her defend him, try to defend him, and she ain't doing nothing. But listen.
From Elijah Muhammad, a man that wrote it in 1930. He said to you before he was even born. So I think that I understand you wanting to make sure that he's fair and a lot of the beliefs that the We Want had back then, but I think you have to also be fair in all of the situations of what was going on during that time. There was a lot of writings, and there's a lot of writings that we live with constantly, and I just think that right now we're going too far, too deep, unnecessarily, to the views of someone else because he's an archivist and he's storing the history. I think if it were anywhere on the website that his picture was with this, the Elijah Muhammad picture is at the top. It's got the acronym of the organization that's restoring the archives. Then I would be troubled myself if he had quotes there or if he identified himself as the belief in this. This is carryover information. So I just want that to be clear for the record that it's right here for everyone to see. And it says it's the bio of someone else who's deceased and been gone for quite a long time.
I agree. We should look at the whole. And let me read another portion for you because I think it goes.
Senator, this
will
be the last one because please, this will be the last one and we need to move on.
Okay, here's the point I want to make. I'm going to read another section of the website for you. And you tell me whether or not this is just archivist or whether or not this is buying into something.
Okay.
The Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah. I'm on the front page of the website. The Coalition for the Remembrance of Elijah Muhammad's website is prepared with sacred reverence to the truth of the teachings of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad.
To his teachings.
Okay, the truth, right. The truth, not the opinion, not just this is what he said, the truth of the teachings, okay? And again, in another line, it says, just the plain truth as given to us by our leader. This supreme wisdom, okay, not what he said, This is the committee saying this. This supreme wisdom, knowledge, and understanding of the words brought to us by our messenger.
You notice, he said, as given to us by our leader. But he tried to now say that he wasn't part of that. He didn't believe that. Well, if you're denying what the leader's saying, then you're not his follower. Huh? But yet he had been telling everybody else that he's a follower. Huh? But listen.
Words brought to us by our messenger will keep us from stumbling and falling. Okay, that's not, gee, this is just what the guy said. This is a very strong statement of belief that what was said in this website, what he said, is the supreme truth. It's wisdom. Now, that's more than just saying, hey, this is what the guy said in the 1930s. This is articulating a belief in it. And I don't know how that could be denied. That's right on the very front page of the website. That's the first thing that people get a look at when they see this. Now, given that, I mean, is that an accurate statement of what this?
You know what? That's why I'm so embarrassed by, to be honest with you, I have not read that in so long. I didn't know everything that you're saying to me. I'm just listening to you, but I think the senator puts it in such great context, and I don't know why you can't see that.
Did you hear him say he's embarrassed by that? And he didn't know that was on that? And he helped he helped compose it. But listen.
But I'm just saying,
okay.
Sir, how did we come here? Did we didn't come here. Do we have to go through this? Do we have to look at our history and see the conditions of us as a people?
Sir, I'm not talking about history.
That's all we're talking about.
Well, I appreciate that's what you want to talk about, but I'm reading a website of which you were part of putting together.
I explained to you.
That talks about supreme truths and beliefs, not this is what this guy said, but these are supreme truths and beliefs. That's pretty strong language.
See, I say under different circumstances, I don't see what you're saying.
Okay, let me.
Senator, please, I want to close it.
Yeah.
Thank you. Senator Lightfoot moves at the
committee. So the other man, the chairman who was, mediator or whatever, he said, Senator, I'm going to close it. And, they didn't affirm him, did they? Yeah. You remember I told you all that a judge cannot, it's certain things that he has to maintain. And I'm just thankful that I have so many brothers who, that knew something about law, and I listened to them when they were talking. And a lot of the judicial system of America, even though they fall short in rendering justice, they do have an idea of how to go about it. It's just like a judge who is so wrapped up in a case personally that he can't keep his neutrality, his respect for the law and the oath that he takes, then if he can't separate his personal from personal opinions and whatnot from a case because of something that he knows about the person or whatnot, then the honorable thing to do, since he is called your what? Your honor. Because everybody who comes into the courtroom has to honor him because of what he represents. He represents the law. And the first one that should honor the law is him. Do you understand? And so the law, the rules that govern his conduct says to him that, if you can't maintain your neutrality, then the lawful thing for you to do is to recuse yourself from that proceeding. Do you understand? Now, you've heard me ask white people, call up if you think that I'm biased against you because you're white and all that old kind of stuff, and you think that I'm just saying something about you that is that I couldn't give you justice or what. You ain't heard no white people call up and tell me that I'm a racist. Why? Because they know I have respect for the Word of God, and the Word of God don't let you be that. The Word of God is what you have to go by, regardless to what your personal opinion is.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum Allah salam.
Son of man, I have a question.
What is your question?
If you don't mind. So the Muslims don't believe in interracial marriage?
No.
Is that against God's law?
Beg your pardon?
Is that interracial marriage, is that against God's law?
when you look at what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, then I'm
not talking about that.
Just a moment.
Mm-hmm. Excuse me.
I don't just believe in one of the messengers of God. I believe in all of them. God's messenger said it should be prohibited. So that's what I say. Now, as far as things that have already passed, I mean, you can't undo what's been done. I'm not telling a man who's into that, in that kind of relationship, that he should go and divorce his wife and that kind of thing. That's impractical. But white people are right to not want you to intermarry with their women, because soon it won't be no white people. You keep doing that. Matter of fact, you keep on doing like that. I mean, what are you saying to your own black woman? If, for instance, I'm black, and this woman done been through slavery with me. She done been through hell with me. And then the minute I get ready to choose me a wife, I go choose somebody that don't look like her. Why would I do that unless I hate myself? That's the one thing that white people was right about with some of us. They say you want they women. I don't want the white man's woman. I got a woman. The black woman, that's my woman. So what is the argument?
Well, my argument
if it was me, and if you ask me what I personally feel about it, I personally don't like it. I don't approve. If you ask me, do you have a right to do it? You got the freedom of choice just like anybody else.
Yes, I know that, sir, but
okay.
Our president.
So what do you want, man? I've answered your question. Do you have another question?
What, and you don't, well, the president believes that gays have the right to get married.
Well, I've already said what I felt about that. You taxing them people. If the government's going to take taxes from them, then they ought to have the same rights that everybody else that's paying taxes got.
Right, because, see, this government...
Now, understand something.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't say I approve of it.
Mm-hmm.
You better learn what words mean. I mean, I wasn't told to go out here and make nobody be righteous. I can't make no homosexual not be a homosexual. But I can tell him that God said he's going to kill him. Now, I ain't going to do nothing to him. I'm not going to beat him up. I'm not going to threaten him. I'm not going to do nothing but tell him what Allah said. Allah said, if a man lie with mankind as he lieth with a woman, they both have committed an abomination. They shall surely be put to death, and their blood shall be upon them. Now, not only does that just mean the physical, that ain't what that's talking about only. You learn, you get an understanding of that which you practice. And so if you practicing a man with a man, then the understanding of relationships that you have is based on what you've been practicing. And so pretty soon you start blaspheming against God. It says, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. Two men can become one flesh. So then you start reinterpreting God's word. Then you start making blasphemous statements about that which you should be holding as sacred and should be respectful of. You start showing disrespect. And then you on your way out, man. Your understanding becomes dark. You know, it's like looking outside, and at night everything looks either black or white. And everybody that can see knows that the universe is not black and white. The universe is color. Everything is color and shade.
It's the rainbow.
So when you look at men with men, the only thing I can tell you, brother, is what Allah told me to tell you. Brother,
well,
that's an abomination.
I understand.
But now it's telling me, do a person have the right to do whatever? Everybody got the right to do whatever they choose to do. As long as you know that whatever you choose to do has a consequence with the Creator.
Well,
I'm not going to do nothing to you.
But
stay out your way.
Like
separate from you. That's what Allah said. He said, come out of her, my people. That you be not partakers of her sin. He didn't say go in there and beat them up. He didn't say go there disrespecting them. He didn't say go cuss them out. He simply said to me, give them warning from me. And that's what I'm doing. Now, if you're practicing that, I would suggest you stop, brother.
Well, I'm a heterosexual. I love
women.
I'm just trying to get an understanding because.
Well, you got understanding. No, you trying to argue with God's word. That's what it sounds like to me. And as far as
I'm trying to
tell you that it's okay with me if you do something that God said don't do. No, it's not okay with me. But I'm not your keeper. But it's not okay with me, and that's why I ain't doing it. But
as far as
what the president and them did, he didn't have no choice but to do what he did. And that was to tell them they have the right, the same rights as every other taxpaying citizen. Especially since the state gave them, in some states, recognition. He promised to uphold the laws and laws of the United States and the Constitution of the United States.
I just see the evolution of time because at one time when
you
we
just
were slaves,
what you hear white people say. I don't see nothing about no evolution. That's not evolution.
To evolve
is to elevate. That word evolve is to elevate.
Right.
That's not elevating.
Time,
that's devolving.
Anytime
you do anything that is detrimental to the well-being of society, you are not evolving.
Correct.
And it's always detrimental to the society to portray immorality as something other than what it is. Now, you can call it what you want, but what it really is immoral behavior.
Can I make one more statement before I get off?
Yeah, you can go on and make your statement.
When we were enslaved here as Africans in America, we weren't allowed to, you know, get our own religion. We weren't allowed to
don't need no history lesson, brother. Don't nobody in here need no history lesson. Black people know that history. Now, what is
this
kind of woman say?
We weren't allowed to marry. Africans weren't allowed. We were treated like cattle. And then,
you can't say we wasn't allowed to marry. I mean, they
might have jumped
the
broom.
That's where they got. Wasn't no marriage like white people did, but they jumped the broom and all that stuff. But
then they divided families.
The point is, brother, the kind of relationships that we had were not actually the relationships that a man and a woman would have, because the man and woman in us had been put to sleep and a boy and girl had been put in his place.
Right.
And so now, you know, I mean, don't come in here trying to teach me. I mean, if you knew anything, if any of you knew anything, why are your conditions so bad? Y'all ain't doing nothing. But you want to come in here and you want to talk to me like you know so much. But if I ask you, what are you doing? Are you setting up schools for our people? Are you finding talented ones and putting resources in their hands to get them to be able to go on and use their talents and teaching them to combine those talents and do for themselves? And if you're not doing any of that, you ought to be quiet. Because I'm doing all that.
I know, sir.
Okay. Well, then don't come in here trying to teach me. If you all had anything to teach, I wouldn't be here. You don't. Those that are whole don't need no physician. Those that are wise don't need no guide. And you just heard a man that thought he was wise. And got made to disown everything that he claimed he believed in. Just to try to hold on to a $49,000 a year job. The simple answer that I was giving you, the answer that he could have gave to me. And you cut me off to go through this thing about homosexuals and stuff.
Well, I know God, Allah, is all merciful, and we're all children under Allah.
No, you don't know Allah. No, the only one know Allah in here is me.
Isn't Allah merciful?
Say, how in the world you know Allah and ain't got no peace? Ain't no peace nowhere, and you claiming you know God? No, you don't.
I'm seeking him.
No, the scripture says, the way of peace have they not known. And since Allah is the author of peace, if you don't know the way of peace, you don't know its author. You notice, I call white people devils and whatnot, and you and when they come to talk with me, you'll notice it's a peaceful conversation. Because, I'm not name calling. I don't name call people. If I call you by a name, I can show you that that's what you are. My name ain't Polly, and I don't need no cracker. Parakeets quote what they hear people say. But if you ask them about what they're saying, they just keep saying the same thing. They don't know what they're saying. But I'm not a parakeet. I understand what I'm saying. If I call the white man the devil, he come in here. I don't care how many of them stand up in front of me. They can't get mad at me because I can show them in the book, the Bible, that they devil. But now, that curse is to be taken off of them. Jesus said he couldn't save them. He said, I have not lost any but the son of perdition, that the scripture might be fulfilled. What scripture? That the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which couldn't nobody else save, that which was lost. And I am the Son of Man. Now, this brother Munir, he done denied everything that he claimed to believe in. Can you see how low he was talking? But listen at him on this.
Lakum. Welcome to another show. My dear brothers and sisters, this is part 12 of One to the Hypocrite. You might ask the question, who am I to talk about hypocrites? Well, I look in the Holy Quran, I listen to the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's description of the hypocrite, and he said, no one likes a hypocrite, whether it's an industrial hypocrite or whether it's a business hypocrite, it doesn't matter. You know, a hypocrite is a hypocrite. That's one saying something out of their mouths which they don't understand.
Now you see why the senator was perturbed with him? The messenger told him, don't nobody like a hypocrite. Whether it's a religious one or in business or whatever. And then he defines a hypocrite as somebody who says something out of their mouth that they don't understand. That's not what a hypocrite is. A hypocrite is not someone who says something out of their mouth that they don't understand. It's they let something come out of their mouth that they don't believe in their heart. They pretend. Huh? But listen.
But very briefly, let me address a couple of critics. We posted Shahrzad Ali's commentary that she did in Philadelphia where we were invited. Well, we brought our camera crew and we filmed her talking. And after she finished, that was it. We didn't film anyone else. Now, those of you who wanted Rodney film, you should have been there to film it. And number two, I did not hear her condemn or say anything negative about Latinos. I'm not even familiar with that word. I don't know who gave you that word, Latino. If a person spoke Spanish, they spoke Spanish. Now, I have some Puerto Rican brothers that I've dealt with throughout this country, so I'm not a person who's opposed to Puerto Ricans being a part of the Nation of Islam, because I've been in the mosque for a long time, and I remember brothers coming from New York speaking. I knew that we had mosque in other parts of the world. I've traveled to San Juan, old San Juan, and spoken to some of the brothers there. So I don't know where you get this nitpicking from, but I'm willing to address it, you know, anyway. But one of the more pressing things that I want to talk about is this latest phenomenon where these so-called black leaders have come out to defend the president-elect Barack Obama, because my understanding, there were some Arabs or Al-Qaeda that condemned Barack Obama as being a house Negro or something to that effect. It eludes me, the exact comment. But what concerns me, there were some Muslims, they tell me, who suggested that the Arabs had not treated us right, they had not tried to give us Islam here. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad spoke about that in his tape, Warning to the Hypocrite. So it shows when the dog comes back to eat its vomit, you know the time is near. And what am I saying? I'm saying those followers that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad raised, and after his departure, they went back to that which they came from by way of his son, Wallace D. Muhammad. We show you signs of that all the time. Even though Wallace has been dead for a couple of months, we will talk about him hence nine forever, because he's part of the history that took us to hell and continue to take us to hell. So I'm saying to you so-called Orthodox Muslims, you cannot have it both ways. Either you with Muhammad or you're not. Don't try and defend him when it's convenient. Now, I want to take you to, but what concerns me, there were some Muslims, they tell me, who suggested that the Arabs had not treated us right, they had not tried to give us Islam here. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad spoke about that in his tape, Warning to the Hypocrite. So it shows when the dog comes back to eat its vomit, you know the time is near. And what am I saying? I'm saying those followers that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad raised, and after his departure, they went back to that which they came from by way of his son, Wallace D. Muhammad. We show you signs of that all the time. Even though Wallace has been dead for a couple of months, but what concerns me, there were some Muslim brothers that I've dealt with throughout this country, So I'm not a person who's opposed to Puerto Ricans being a part of the Nation of Islam, because I've been in the mosque for a long time, and I remember brothers coming from New York speaking. I knew that we had mosques in other parts of the world. I've traveled to San Juan, old San Juan, and spoken to some of the brothers there. So I don't know where you get this nitpicking from, but I'm willing to address it, you know, anyway. But one of the more pressing things that I want to talk about is this latest phenomenon where these so-called black leaders have come out to defend the president-elect Barack Obama, because my understanding, there were some Arabs or Al-Qaeda that condemned Barack Obama as being a house Negro or something to that effect. It eludes me, the exact comments. But what concerns me, there were some Muslims, they tell me, who suggested that the Arabs had not treated us right, they had not tried to give us Islam here. And the Honorable Elijah Muhammad spoke about that in his tape, Warning to the Hypocrite. So it shows when the dog comes back to eat its vomit, you know the time is near. And what am I saying? I'm saying those followers that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad raised, and after his departure, they went back to that which they came from by way of his son, Wallace D. Muhammad. We show you signs of that all the time. Even though Wallace has been dead for a couple of months, we will talk about him, hence nine forever, because he's part of the history that took us to hell and continue to take us to hell. So I'm saying to you so-called Orthodox Muslims, you cannot have it both ways. Either you with Muhammad or you're not. Don't try and defend him when it's convenient. Now, I want to take you to a...
Now, what was he doing on that tape there? When it was inconvenient? I don't believe that no more. But now, did he sound timid? But you notice in that hearing, he was timid. You can't be like that, brother. Your own words said, don't do that. That's all I'm saying. Now, I don't really blame none of y'all. I'm just pointing out to you that you can't do my job. That's what I'm trying to show you. It's not your job to defend black people. That's my job. The messenger told you, you have God with you. He said, what must be done? We don't have to sit around here and ask the question. What must be done? We have God with us. We have him as our guide. When he, the God of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. You say, it don't say that. It say the spirit of truth. God is the spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So when he, the spirit of truth, he, the God of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. You know, you have to remember that you don't have a right to force yourself on nobody. You don't have a right to force your way on people. There's no compulsion in release. We have pointed out to man the two conspicuous ways he can be thankful or unthankful. But when it all said and done, when the judgment of God comes down for or against you, you're not going to be able to blame nobody but yourself. Do you understand? And whoever you follow, you're going to deny them at that point. When you see the chastisement, you're going to deny them, and they're going to deny you. You see? Listen to what the Honorable Elijah Muhammad said. I'm going to let you hear this.
through patience and prayer. You need to have both. You need to say your prayer. And you need to be patient. So wait on the Lord and don't try to run ahead. The 45th verse says, seek assistance through patience and prayer. You need to have both. You need to say your prayer. And you need to be patient. So wait on the Lord and don't try to run ahead. Because you can't see the head run. You'll run into something that you cannot put out of your way. Very beautiful.
Well, Munir ran into something he couldn't put out of his way. If I had a job that was like his, if I had had that job and the man had asked me about my belief, at first I said, yes, sir, that's what I believe personally. That's the first thing I'd have told him. Secondly, I would have told him, but I understand my personal beliefs ain't got no place in this public forum. And I can't force my beliefs on other people. In the same way I have a right to my personal beliefs, they have a right to theirs. And that would have ended that. To a civilized man, long as he know I understand that I can't force my personal beliefs on other people, especially being, and these people's tax money paying my salary. Then whatever the law allows for them, then that's none of my business. The only thing I can do is what the law allows, and that's all I will ever try to do. Just like a president. A president can have personal beliefs about whatever. You can't nobody take that from you. You don't have to apologize for your personal beliefs. But when you start trying to force your personal beliefs on everybody else, then we got a problem. See, even the scripture said there's no compulsion in religion. So your religious beliefs, you don't have a right to force on anyone. The scripture says train the child up in the way that they ought to go, and when he becomes an old, he will not depart from it. Huh? Now, the one you should be trying to put the belief in is your child. Guide them to it. And show grown people that you understand that they are not your children. And don't be out there on the street trying to make everybody dress like you or walk like you or talk like you. And recognize that if people do like you, they have to choose to. And nobody gonna choose to be like a fool if they got any sense. You certainly not gonna attract nobody to your way if your way is not intelligent, unless they are not intelligent, and then they are attracted. You know, you'd be surprised what people are attracted to. But wise people are not attracted to foolishness. And you will never attract me into a religious doctrine that's so weak that when somebody asks you questions about it, see, the only times I'm short with people is when they start questioning the word of God. As though they're going to argue with it, as though we got a choice in obeying. I ain't got no choice in obeying God's word. And as far as I'm concerned, you ain't either. And as far as wanting to argue with Allah, then you take that up with him. What you come in here with me for? I agree with God, period. And the scripture says, as you would that men do to you, do ye also unto them. If a man practicing homosexuality, or if a man practicing whatever wrong that Allah said don't do, then I'm going to give him warning, because that's what I would like done to me. But now, after I warn him, I will leave him alone, because that's what I'd like done to me. Do you understand? You give me warning and let me know. You know, once you put it on my mind, it's up to me what I do with it. What is that? Yeah, to quit. I'm going to quit. But I'm going to quit when I was thinking about that. I've been looking at the clock. But I'm trying to make sure everybody understands that, see, the messengers knew that this was coming. And he told you. He said, you can't be the head runner, because you will run into something that you can't put out of your way. You see how simple I made the answer? Because Allah have made me a man. I'm going to create a man, a mortal. I'm going to teach him. It would have been simple for him to just tell them, look, I know my personal beliefs don't agree with everybody else's, and everybody else's. I'm pretty sure you, Senator, you got personal opinions about things. What's your religion? What do you believe in as far as such and so? Does that hinder you from practicing justice in when you're making laws and rulings and whatnot? You have to keep in consideration that people that you disagree with, people that you don't like, also pay taxes just like you. And if you're not willing to give them justice, you need to step aside. So I understand that. But I also understand that I don't have to be agreeing with everything that everybody who come into my office is about. I got to agree with them in order to serve them. I know what my job description is, and I will always do that job according to the description of that job. And when I feel that I can't do that, you won't have to tell me to step aside. Because I'm a Muslim first. Do you understand? And a Muslim believe in justice. No, I don't agree with interracial marriage. But that's me. That's why I ain't doing it. But if that somebody else does it, well, that's their business. I got nothing to do with that. Do you understand? You see? You know? So, you know, this is the only country where that really have to come up, because other countries ain't even like this one. Most countries, Japan got mostly Japanese people there. That man ain't got to worry about who his daughter gonna marry. She's going to marry somebody look like her, because that's all that's there. You know, y'all done went crazy. So you know, I want the black woman. I don't want no, you know, I'm satisfied with the black woman. You know. And if she ain't satisfied with the black man, bye. You know, go to it. Do what you want. Just do it away from me. So that's the way that goes. And I agree with the Klan on that. Leave that man's woman alone, man. You know, you trying to erase him. And I don't blame him. I wouldn't want you erasing my people. Let him have his people. Let him be himself. And you be yourself. Even lions and tigers don't do what you're doing. And they in the jungle together. And you don't see no, unless you put them together. No lion over there sweethearting with no tiger. Zebras go with zebras. Everything go with itself. Tell me, do the creator say what? Well, the book of life says it. But you got creatures like dogs and whatnot. Dogs, ego, mount up on whatever. Well, that's it, ain't it? And it said on the outside is what? Dogs. Everyone that loveth and maketh a lie. Yeah. So I know what I'm dealing with. And now you're mad at me because you calling me no dog? No, I ain't calling you no dog. I'm telling you that's the way of dogs. You know, horses don't go. Horse go with a horse. Do you understand? Unless you put him with a donkey, he ain't going with no donkey. You got to do that. So, you know, you learn to be satisfied with your own. Now that everybody is produced here, let's try to keep them here. Best way to keep them here is let them reproduce with their own kind. Do you understand? All right. So, but there again, that's choice. Now, if I was going to be in there, you know, I could get a job in the government or any place else, and they wouldn't have to worry about me trying to be there doing other than my job description. You know, if you apply for a job, you ought to know what the description of that job is. That way you don't violate, you know, the job description. And if once you know what the job calls for, if you can't do that, don't apply for the job. Do you understand? Okay. Now, actually, that's the answer the man wanted to hear. He didn't want to hear you sitting up there talking about you don't believe that. I mean, he already know you believe it. At least you say you did. But he just want to know how you going to act. Do you understand what your job calls for? Because that contradicts your personal beliefs. Now, can you get past your personal beliefs and do this job? And if he got to ask you, he's waiting on you to come out and tell him that. And then when you sitting up there talking about, well, I don't know why you asking me this, and oh, man, you tripping. And he was right to call him on. He made him deny the teachings. He made him do it and still didn't get the job. Because everybody hates a hypocrite. Didn't he say that? The messenger told him, don't nobody like a hypocrite, whether he's religious or business or whatever. Nobody likes a hypocrite. You see? What you think even in the police department, they have an internal affairs division. You know what that's for? To catch hypocrites who pretending to be police officers but crooked. You understand? But they out there going out every day like they really going to uphold the law and they crooks. You see? Don't nobody like a hypocrite, man. So that's the way that goes. So, you know, Allah gives me the answers to everything that every problem you got. Yeah, matter of fact, y'all can't ask me no question about life that I can't answer. You are white people. So when I say you are white people, that means all colors in between. See, we the extremes, black, white, and then you got all these in between. So we are, you know, I know you think I was hard on my brother. I wasn't hard on brother. I was trying to show him that, you know, the things you asking me about is actually irrelevant to what is being discussed here. I mean, you already know my position on homosexuality and all of that stuff. My position is the position that the Word of God takes, period. It's wrong. But it's your choice if that's what you want to do. Huh? But he done told you what the consequences are. I mean, this government has a position on capital murder. It carries the death penalty in some states. If you're in one of them states that it carries the death penalty, now you go and commit capital murder, I mean, the public ain't gonna do it to you. The government gonna do it to you. Well, why you don't understand that if God made the law, God the one gonna call you to account? If Allah said this was gonna happen to you, you ain't got to worry about what I'm gonna do to you. You better be worrying about what He said He gonna do. But you don't believe He's a He. You don't believe He's got no authority over you. But He's made you. He's made you just like that young man that killed himself, a homosexual, because his roommate took a picture of him doing something with his partner. If he thought he was right, why would he go kill himself? I mean, if that's just a natural happening, I mean, so you got caught. I mean, we used to go, when I was a youngster, we'd go to the park, see people on blankets and stuff, and slip around trying to get a peek or whatever. And people didn't care nothing about you looking at them because they didn't feel they was doing nothing wrong. You got people on the... I know y'all and some of y'all have been on them Playboy channels. They got people take movies of themselves doing stuff. But when God, see, He made us, and He put a fail-safe in each of us. It's embedded in our nature to condemn certain things and condone other things. The minute you heard the lesbian and the homosexual, now y'all listen to me who practicing that. There was a time when you hid in the closet. The reason you was hiding in the closet doing that, you didn't want nobody to know that you was that, was because in your mind, your own mind was condemning it. Allah's going to bring that back up. Yeah, I don't care how much you think you done forgot it. There's a day coming when He's going to turn the self-accusing spirit, the mind, the self-correcting. Even the Caucasian told you. And what did he say? That the mind, let me show you now. He wrote on this. He said, our experts warned us about the possibility of this phenomenon occurring, for they say that the mind has a strong drive to correct and recorrect itself. Does man think no one sees him? Or that no one hears him? Has he not eyes? Has he not ears? Then man is sufficient as a witness against himself. That's what the Holy Quran says. What that mean? Allah don't have to go get no witnesses to what you did. When the time comes, you will be your witness. That's why the judge gave that boy 30 days. Because you can't blame him for this other one going committing suicide. What are you trying to do? No. It's a whole lot of things when it start happening. It's a day of temptation. It's a great day of temptation. That's why those Secret Service men did what they was doing. They don't know what time they're living in. This is a day where you ain't safe. You don't have no righteousness of your own, which means you don't have a mind that you're not strong enough to resist temptation unless you put on the armor of God. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And as you do that, then the righteousness of Allah will protect you and save you out of the temptations and deliver you and show you a way around that stuff. But if you don't, you're going to fall victim to it. I don't care if you're the president of the United States. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devils that's in you. You ain't got to go looking outside of yourself for diseases. They all inside of you. Your immune system is what's protecting you. The whole armor of God is what you need. That's your immunity. The word of God. If you don't have much of his word in you, your immune system ain't working. And you're going to fall victim. So, you know. So I'm going to stop right here. If it was Friday, I'd keep it going. Don't do no good to tell people to remind you if you ain't going to pay no attention. So I'm going to get on. But I had already thought about that. I was looking at the clock. And it's almost 10:30 now. I better get out of here. May Allah continue to bless us all, keep us safe, and in our right minds. And help us make it through this next 24 hours without offending him, nor harming our own souls. Allah's salam alaikum.